Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org, and today I will show you a few things you shouldn't do when you retrieve your query result as a stream. JPA 2.2 added the getResultStream method to the query interface. It provides you the query result as a stream so that you can process it with the stream API. But before you do that, please watch this video. There are several things you shouldn't do with your stream because the database can do them much better. And I summarized all of them in a handy cheat sheet, which I will share at the end of this video. But before I talk about all the things you should avoid, let's take a quick look at the getResultStream method. You can see a simple example here on the slide. It was added to the query interface, and when you execute a query, you just call the getResultStream method instead of the getResultList method. The rest of the API didn't change, so you can create the query, set bind parameter values, and limit the number of selected records in the same way as you did in JPA 2.1. The method and its intention are described by the JPA specification, but the implementation depends on the persistence provider, and you should check the documentation and code before you use it. The default implementation, provided by the query interface, just calls the getResultList method to retrieve the result set as a list and calls the stream method to transform it into a stream. This approach doesn't provide any benefits compared to the getResultList method available in JPA 2.1. But it's to be expected that most JPA implementations provide their own implementation of the getResultStream method. Hibernate, for example, introduced its stream method in version 5.2, and I would be surprised if they don't reuse it for JPA's getResultStream method. It uses Hibernate's scrollable result implementation to move through the result set and to fetch the records in batches. That prevents you from loading all records of the result set at once and allows you to process them more efficiently. Since the introduction of streams in Java 8, I saw a lot of examples on blogs and in forum posts. They are often used to process huge amounts of data. The Stream API was designed for that, and it's a great way to process data that you read from a file or got via an API call. But be careful if you got your data from a database. You can, of course, use the Stream API to process selected entities or DTOs. But there are several things that the database can do a lot better than your Java code. So make sure to distribute the processing step intelligently so that you use the database and your business tier as efficiently as possible. Here are a few things you should better do within your query and not via the Stream API. The filtering of elements in a stream was one of the first examples that I saw when Java 8 introduced the Stream API. The filter method allows you to select the elements in the stream that fulfill certain criteria. Its implementation is easy, and for some Java developers, it's more comfortable to implement the filter criteria in the Java code instead of the JPQL query. But that's something you shouldn't do. Databases are optimized for this use case and can do that a lot faster. So please, don't implement any additional filter when you process your stream. You should better use JPQL or the Criteria API to specify the filter criteria in your query. And if that's not possible, you can still use a native SQL query. I explained the capabilities of JPQL in great detail in a blog post, so I will add the link to it to the video description and give you just a short overview of what you can do in a WHERE clause. You can use several compare operators, access the attributes of all entities referenced in the from clause or implicitly joined via the path operator. And you can even call database functions to trigger more complex operations. Another thing you shouldn't do is limiting the number of elements in the stream. The Stream API provides several methods to cancel the processing or to retrieve certain elements from the stream. And you can do the same within your queries. So, which is the better approach? You should, of course, only select the database records that you want to process in your application. So, if you already know that you just need a certain number of records, you should limit the size of the result set within the query. Typical examples are queries that select the most recent record that fulfills certain criteria, or that retrieve a list of records that will be presented in a paginated list in the UI. The reason why you should do that within your query is simple. The number of records you select can influence the execution plan of your query. For example, indexes might be used or not used based on the number of selected records. That increases the execution time of your query. Building a bigger result set in the database also requires more resources, and due to this, slows down your database server. So, better use the setResultSet and setMaxResult methods in the query and typed query interface. I explained that in one of my Hibernate tip videos in more detail. Let's take a look. With JPA and Hibernate, you have to set the pagination information on the query interface and not on the query string as you know it from SQL. You can do that by calling the setFirstResult and setMaxResults methods. The code snippet here on the slide shows a simple example that returns the first 5 authors from the database. The result set index is 0-based, and you therefore need to provide 0 as a start position to begin with the first element. Let's jump into the IDE and give it a try. Here you can see the same query as I showed you on the slide. It selects all author entities from the database in the ascending order of their primary key. I only want to show the first 5 authors to the user. I therefore set MaxResults to 5, so that the query returns only 5 entities, and the first result to 0, so that I get the first 5 author entities. As you can see here, Hibernate generated an SQL query and used the MaxResult values to create a limit clause. Okay, let's now assume the user wants to see the next 5 authors. I prepared that in another test case. You can see it here. The only difference to the previous one is the value that I provide to the setFirstResult method. Instead of 0, I now set it to 5, so that the query returns the 6th to 10th author from the database. Hibernate generated the same query and just set a different value for the offset parameter, so that the database returns the 5 next records from the author table. And you should also not sort the elements of the stream. You could use the sorted method provided by the stream interface to sort the elements of your stream. But that's another operation which the database can do much faster than your Java code. You just need to add an order by clause to your query, and the database returns the result set in your preferred order. In JPQL, you can do that with a similar syntax as you probably know from SQL. Your persistence provider will then add an order by clause to the SQL query, and your database will return the result set in the defined order. You can then use the stream to iterate through the result set. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like a cheat sheet for this video and an ebook about the Java 8 support in Hibernate 5. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you like today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!